Welcome to Timeless with Vivek Nitur. Our guest today is Professor Kaushal Verma. Professor Kaushal Verma is Professor of Mathematics and Dean of the Division of Physical and Mathematical Sciences at the Indian Institute of Science, Bangalore. His research interests include complex analysis, dynamical systems, and ergodic theory. Kaushal graduated with a BTech in Engineering Physics from IIT Bombay in 1992 and subsequently earned a PhD in Mathematics from Indiana University, Bloomington in 1999 and was a research assistant professor at the University of Michigan, Ann Arbor before returning to India to join the Indian Institute of Science in 2004. He is the recipient of the Swarna Jayanti Fellowship and Bhatnagar Prize. I know Kaushal from the time that I was an undergraduate student at IIT Bombay and am hence very excited to be interviewing him today. Hi, Kaushal.
Hi, Vivek. Very happy to be here with you and thank you for this opportunity to participate in this program.
So, Kaushal, could you please share your memories of Hostel 3 and also of being an engineering physics student at IIT Bombay?
Yeah, sure, Vivek. When I look back at that period, when we were all students in Bombay, I realized that this was one of the best moments of my life so far. Coming from growing up in Pune, when I came to Bombay for the first time, the campus was something that really took me by surprise. There were all these hostels and big buildings and, playgrounds and so on and so forth. And, when we settled down into the hostel, it was so much fun. The opportunities to participate in extracurricular activities were there all over. And I still remember, I happened to sort of walk into the dark room, which the photography club had. And this was the first time that I was actually entering into such a facility. I had never been to one such thing. And this was the first time when I actually saw how you, develop these films, photographs and so on. It was very exciting. And then you had the mountaineering club and, for the first time I saw these, equipment and backpacks and so on that people could rent. And I think the wingmates that I had and the general hostel friends, this is something that I was very fortunate to have, very, very positive people. And, everybody had interests of their own. So what really happened was everybody sort of grew up learning lots of things. And I still remember really wonderful impromptu discussions on, theater, the theory of relativity, what was happening across the country, and, solving the times crossword in the morning before going to the lectures and participating in, the inter-hostel games and so on. So it was a beautiful time, Vivek, growing up with all of my friends there. And whenever I meet these people here in Bangalore, I always tell them that, look, so many things could have gone wrong, because we were all very impressionable at that time. But I think I consider myself to be very fortunate to have had that kind of friend circle. This is something that I really look back very, very fondly, Vivek, yes.
Kaushal, the other question is that your schoolmates actually say that you are very strongly interested in chemistry at school. So how did you get interested in mathematics? And how did you take engineering physics at IIT Bombay?
Okay. Yes, Vivek, that is true. So in Pune, I studied in Bishop School. This was a school that was founded in 1864. We had some very, very fine teachers, excellent teachers for history, English, geography, and all the basic sciences and mathematics. I still remember all of them very, very vividly and the impression that they left on me. In particular, I remember our chemistry teacher, Mr. Singh. He was a very, very friendly person. He knew his subject very well, and he also knew how to inspire students, you know. And what really happened was, in class 9, we were taken into the main laboratory of the school for the first time. This was an old structure built in the style of army barracks. So there was a central table where the experiment was conducted by Mr. Singh. And, you know, the seating facility was like a theater, you know. So we had a slope, a gentle slope. And all of our students were asked to sit in specific positions. And we would all see what Mr. Singh was doing on that big, large table here. So it was all very fascinating, Vivek. And, you know, chemistry came across as a subject which was very tangible, you know. You could have a lot of fun playing around with test tubes and mixing chemicals and so on and so forth. And of course, you know, it had this aspect in which, you know, you were given an unknown salt and you had to go through a series of steps to actually analyze and identify what the salt was. So it all appealed to me because it was, you know, sort of like becoming a detective in some sense, you know. And Mr. Singh was such a wonderful teacher. So chemistry was a subject that really appealed to me in the beginning. And then later on, what happened was that my father's younger brother, my uncle, who stays in Bombay, he used to work for a company that would manufacture specialized chemicals, you know. And when I gradually, you know, started talking to him and told him that, look, you know, I really like this subject. All of a sudden, one fine day, he came back with a big box, and I asked him, you know, Chacha, what's in this? He said, no, open it up and see for yourself. And, you know, to my surprise, it had a whole bunch of test tubes and, you know, these beakers and pipettes and, you know, flasks. And he also had brought along some harmless little chemicals. He said, go ahead and do what you want with it, you know. So this was the beginning of setting up of a little lab at home. and yeah, Vivek, so I told my mother that, look, can I have a little corner at home? And she said, yeah, sure, go ahead. So I got myself a little table and I arranged all these little things as carefully as I could. And drawing inspiration from Mr. Singh, you know, I said I must have a lab manual. So I got a separate notebook. And I started maintaining, you know, things as meticulously as I could. So I would, you know, do one experiment per day, you know. So that was my agenda. So I would begin by noting the date, and then I would write the aim of the experiment, and then I would list all the equipment that I was using. And then I would try to, you know, go back to what Mr. Singh had taught us. He said, look, chemistry is incomplete without a balanced equation and so on. So I would try to write down an equation and try to balance it. And, you know, looking back, Vivek, that was a very instructive period. You know, it was so much fun and I really enjoyed doing all that. So chemistry left a very deep impression. But then what happened was, you know, when we moved to class 10, 11, and 12, something sort of happened, Vivek, you know, I cannot really sort of put my finger on it now. It seems such a long time ago. But our mathematics teacher also, you know, started talking about many, many interesting things. it was all, you know, things that he was talking about in the syllabus. But the way he taught us and the kind of things that he was talking about, you know, quadratic equations, how do you sketch the graph of a quadratic equation just by looking at the coefficient of x squared, for example, you know, things of that sort. So he was trying to inculcate a certain way of thinking in us. And all of that started settling down in a certain way in my mind. And I started enjoying mathematics also. and it all sort of started there, Vivek, you know. So chemistry to start with, and then mathematics, and then slowly mathematics sort of became much more appealing. In class 11 and 12, we had a wonderful teacher, Mr. Khanapure. So I had moved to St. Vincent's in Pune for class 11 and 12. Mr. Khanapure was a senior person, but again, you know, somebody who came across as being very impressionable in his own way, you know. So he used to walk very slowly. He always had a bunch of notebooks with him in his hand. And those notebooks had a bunch of incredible problems, you know, as I look back now. And his thing was, he would walk into class, wish us good morning, and then the first thing he would do is turn around and write a problem on the board. So Khanapure was somebody who again left a very strong impression on me. The way he approached the subject, the way he taught us, and his very dry sense of humor, you know, really appealed to me. And soon enough, you know, I sort of found myself really, really drawn to the subject just by doing some reading on my own and so on. So that's how sort of mathematics really caught up, actually. And engineering physics, you know, coming to engineering physics, a whole bunch of us wrote the JEE, and I did not really know what this exam was all about and what's going to happen if I cleared it. But my father had told me that, look, the campus is very nice and, you know, you'll get a good education and so on. And so I said, fine, let's write the exam. We'll see what happens. And once I had cleared it, I sort of told my father that maybe I want to do mathematics. But I wasn't really sure myself, you know, because one studies mathematics in class 11 and 12, and one doesn't really know what the subject is all about. So he said, well, if you're confused, you know, let's go and meet somebody who can advise us. And it so happened that he took me to Professor M.J. Patni, who was Dean of Student Affairs during our time. And Professor Patni was somebody who was my father's childhood friend, as I came to know of later, you know. And Professor Patni, you know, he said, well, you know, why don't you think about engineering physics? It has a good blend of, physics and electrical engineering. And there's a good bit of mathematics. So you're going to get exposed to a number of things. So I said, fine, you know, this sounds reasonable. So that's how I ended up taking engineering physics.
Kaushal, it was really great to learn about Professor Khanapure and to also know that, Professor Patni, whom we all remember from our times at IIT Bombay, played an important role in you actually taking engineering physics. So this is news to me. So this is, great to hear.
Yes.
So which professors at IIT Bombay influenced you the most?
There were a number of them, Vivek. I would like to begin by mentioning Anant Mahajan, S.H. Patil, B.V. Limay, Akhil Ranjan, G.V. Das. These are some names that come to my mind. And I will briefly mention the reasons also. Yeah. let me start off with the physics faculty. Anant Mahajan, S.H. Patil are two people that I remember for one very simple reason. You know, they were so approachable, so different from other teachers that I had been exposed to so far. Anant Mahajan went to the extent of, accompanying us on some of our weekend treks, for example. And he was the person who really, advised us on so many things apart from academics, he really told us, how life should be led in some sense. And I am sort of really grateful to him for all that advice, And he did not, pontificate. His attitude was, yes, let's all have fun together. I'm like you. There's no real difference. Let's all have fun, So that was his approach. S.H. Patil, on the other hand, was somebody who knew his subject very well. We were all in awe of him just because of the way he taught, the number of courses that he taught us. And most importantly, Vivek, his style of examining us, So this was the first time that I was introduced to the concept of an open book exam. And he said, look, here's a question paper. It was 9 in the morning. And he said, you can do whatever you want, except that you don't discuss it amongst yourselves. And the turn in time is, you know, 6 in the evening or something like that. You can go have tea. You can eat your lunch. Do whatever you want. And I said, look, you know, here is the person who trusts all of us so much. It's just a wonderful way of, you know, asking us to engage in the course. So I really remember him for this gesture. G.V. Das, again, is somebody I remember very well, simply because, you know, despite his poor health, you know, he used to take enormous effort in preparing for each and every lecture, Vivek. You know, I had not seen such a meticulous professor before. He would come prepared with all his notes. He used to have difficulties in, you know, even speaking at times, but he did his best, Vivek, you know. And I really am thankful to him. He taught us a number of courses, mathematical physics, quantum mechanics 1 and 2, and so on and so forth. But, you know, the effort that he put in was just incredible, Vivek, you know, despite his ill health. Professor Limai and Akhil Ranjan are two people very grateful to, simply because, you know, I tried to... So in Bombay, you know, after 2 or 3 years, you know, I said, look, maybe I want to pursue a PhD in mathematics and not continue with physics. And so I was in a dilemma because I had not taken too many mathematics courses and I wanted guidance. B.V. Limai and Akhil Ranjan were two people who actually gave their time very freely. They even encouraged me to do the seminar and the final year BTech project in mathematics. And it is because of their help and guidance that I was actually able to learn a little bit during those years. So I did my seminar with Limai and my final year project with Akhil Ranjan and Urjit Yajnik as my co-advisor in physics. So a number of people have helped, Vivek. Looking back, you know, I think I'm sort of very fortunate to have got this very timely help and support from all quarters without even asking for it, Vivek. You know, it just came by and I said, look, you know, wonderful, wonderful. And apart from this, I also want to mention Agashe. You know, again, he was one person with whom a bunch of us took very interesting elective courses, very, very interesting.
Kaushal, I think you're referring to the course called Logic and Foundations of Mathematics, which we took in our final semester.
Exactly, exactly. Logic and Foundations of Mathematics. And, you know, the whole exposure that we got, Vivek, was so nice, I think. Very, very nice. So these are some people that I really remember very fondly, actually. Yes.
It is really great to listen to the names of professors from our times. It's very nostalgic indeed.
Yes, yes.
So moving to your graduate work at Indiana Bloomington, could you please share your experiences there? I am very interested to learn more about the episode where you were thinking very deeply about a research problem and missed your bus stop.
yes. So let me begin with my final year in Bombay. I think that's the right place to start. So, you know, all of us were trying to apply abroad for a PhD someplace. And I decided to apply mostly in mathematics and maybe 2 or 3 places in physics also. I got accepted in 2 places. One was Louisiana State University for mathematics. And the other one was Indiana University in Bloomington. Bloomington came a little later. I sent a thank you note to Louisiana and said, look, I'm going to Bloomington. Simply because people told me it's a much better place. So I said, fine, we'll do that. You know, when I first landed up there, Vivek, I was actually taken aback, to be very honest. Because, you know, coming from a big place like Bombay, Bloomington was a very pretty place, but a very, very small place. Apart from the university, there was nothing much in the town. And I actually started feeling lost there, you know, to start off with. So it took me more than a year to settle down there, actually, just to feel comfortable there. but anyway, you know, it was a phase, and one has to sort of go through this transition to the best of one's abilities. Now, when I reached Bloomington, I was not really sure about what I wanted to study. So I took a whole bunch of courses simply because I wanted to see for myself and test the waters first, you know, before signing up with an advisor. So I was not sure, and it so happened that in my second year, the department hired a new faculty member, Sergei Pinchuk. I actually attended his job talk also. Job talks are open to the public, so I also sat through it. And I had no clue about what he was talking about, you know, Vivek. But the way he spoke actually again left a deep impression on me. And I said, look, maybe I should talk to him and see if he can take me on as a student. Pinchuk was somebody who was trying to move to the US from Russia. and his specialty was complex analysis, several complex variables. And, you know, I mustered courage and strength to actually go and talk to him. And he said, well, okay, we'll see, you know, why don't you start reading something? So that was the beginning of the whole thing, Vivek, you know. But here's, let me make a little digression to, you know, share a story with you, Vivek, you know. looking back, you know, my life seems to be full of so many accidents, fortunate ones. And I'm really thankful to the cosmos, so to speak. You know, in Bombay, Vivek, you know, I had this habit of taking the local train from Vikhroli, Kanjurmarg, and going all the way up to VT on the weekends, you know. Because there were a number of very good bookstalls, you know. You had these people who would sell books on the footpaths and so on, you know, that kind of thing. And many of these people had incredible treasures, you know, this book and that book and so on. So during these visits, I actually managed to buy lots and lots of classics in complex analysis. For example, I picked up Copson's classic on complex analysis. I picked up Hardy's book on, modern mathematics. I picked up Tish Marsh's book on the theory of functions. I picked up Whittaker and Watson. And I picked them up not because I understood what was written in them, simply because these books were so beautifully printed, hardbound. They had these yellow pages. And the whole thing, you know, was so appealing. You know, I said, look, I must have this. So I had this big collection of books in complex analysis with me. when I left for Bloomington, I said, look, these are the only books in mathematics that I have, so I must take all of them with me. So here I was in Bloomington with all these books on complex analysis. And the thought of working in complex analysis had never even crossed my mind, you know. I said, let me go and see what's happening. So this was sort of like a loop being closed, you know, in hindsight. So I go up to Pinchuk and I said, look, can I sign up with you for a thesis in complex analysis? so I still have those books with me, Vivek. I think they are some things that I really cherish. so that's how I sort of got into this whole thing with several complex variables. And so Bloomington was, you know, as I realized, it was well known in the area of several complex variables. Pinchuk was a new addition to the already existing group, which consisted of people like Tom Bagby, Eric Bedford, and Norm Levenberg. And these four people, namely Pinchuk, Bedford, Bagby, and Norm Levenberg, Vivek, these are people I'm deeply grateful to for teaching me whatever I know today. These were the most friendliest people that I have come across in the mathematics community in the US, very open, very giving. And and these were people with whom I was, you know, able to be just by myself, you know. I did not have to sort of tighten up and pretend to be something else. I could ask the most incredibly stupid questions to them, and they would go to the blackboard and answer things with a smile, you know, without getting frustrated and so on. So these are people who have really shaped my thinking, not only in mathematics, but, you know, the whole philosophy of academics, so to speak, you know. And it was a lot of fun, Vivek. So I was in Bloomington for 7 years. Every Wednesday, there would be a complex analysis seminar. And, you know, these people were, you know, influential enough to invite the best speakers across the country and so on. So I got a chance to meet with many, many people who were practitioners of this field. And you get to hear a number of very interesting talks. And my interest, you know, Vivek, in related areas like complex dynamics actually started from these times, because Bedford was actually lecturing about his new theories about the dynamics of what are called Hinnon mappings. Yeah. So he was actually struggling to prove his theorems, and whenever it was done, we got to hear it on a Wednesday seminar, and this is how the whole thing was progressed. I was seeing this in front of my own eyes. Pinchuk was proving very important theorems, and I got to see them in real life, Vivek, you know. So here's a practicing mathematician, here's a brand new theorem, and this is how you sort of present it in some sense. Bagby was somebody who taught me the first course in complex analysis. Bagby was a student of Alfors. Alfors is a household name in this area, the first Fields medalist, you know. Still remember Tom Bagby's very distinctive style of lecturing. so much fun, Vivek, so much fun. And Norm Levenberg, you know, was somebody who was so friendly, Vivek, so friendly. We had him over for dinner at our place. And he gave of himself in such a beautiful manner, Vivek, you know, just by being there, just by being there. Nothing special, but you're there. That's about it. So those were wonderful times, Vivek. And I look back at that period with a great deal of satisfaction. Yes. And now coming to this incident that you have raised. So this is something that I really, you know, enjoy sharing with my friends. So what happened was, you know, Pinchuk had told me that, look, you know, here's an interesting question. Why don't you think about it? You know, I don't really know the answer to this. This was 4 in the evening when he told me this. And I said, oh, my goodness, this is so fascinating, you know. This was after I had done a year-long course with him. So I actually understood the full import of the question. What was he asking and what was needed to actually, you know, try and get started on that. So I said, okay, Sergey, I'll think about it. And I said, okay, let me, you know, go back home now. It was winter time and it was already dark. So I got into the bus you know, my mind was full of the problem. You know, the world did not exist around me. I was only thinking about the problem. And the bus sort of made its way very slowly through the snowy streets and so on. And then it was stopping at various places, but I was completely oblivious of everything, Vivek, trust me, you know. And it stopped at one place and I sort of got out of my reverie and I said, oh, this is a nice apartment. You know, maybe I should consider seeing if they have a vacancy. And I thought this much and the bus moved on again and I did not think anything about it. A full 10 minutes had gone past by, Vivek, when I realized that, oh my goodness, what I had seen was my own apartment. That's the place where I, you know, was living for the past several years and I should have gotten down there, you know. This was so embarrassing. And it became doubly challenging because after this stop, you know, there was a wooded area in the town. And in this wooded area, there was no bus stop for a while. So I was actually stuck, you know. So I was in the bus and it was moving, and it was only after a while that it stopped and I was able to get down. So you can imagine, it was dead of winter, dead in the middle of the winter. And I had to walk back home. It was fiercely cold. And I was cursing myself for, you know, being so absent-minded at that time. Yes. So this is something which has happened. So funny, I think. Now, yeah.
Kaushal, it is deeply inspiring to hear about the four professors that you mentioned at Bloomington and their impact on you, the Wednesday seminars, and the entire mechanics of proving mathematics coming live in these Wednesday seminars. You know, this seems really wonderful. And also, this story of you missing the bus stop, you know, is a favorite one of all your friends, you know, as you write this.
Yes, yes.
So could you please share your experiences at Syracuse University, where you were between Indiana, Bloomington, and Michigan, Ann Arbor?
Right. Right. So I finished in 1999 from Bloomington, and I got a one-year visiting position at Syracuse. And Syracuse, I went simply because, you know, they again had a small group of people working in complex analysis. And the main person here was somebody that Pinchuk knew personally. His name is Yevgeny Poletsky. And Poletsky was another Russian who had moved to the US many years ago. And Poletsky is again somebody I remember very fondly because of all the extra help that he gave me, Vivek, you know. Can you believe this? You know, I reached Syracuse. I haven't even gone to the department when Poletsky, calls me up. And he says, look, you know, you are probably not familiar with town. So let me help you do your groceries and let's buy some furniture for you. So here is somebody whom I have met precisely once before. And he takes the trouble to actually tell me that, look, let's go shopping. You are new to the place. You know, extremely kind gestures, you know. And I, of course, said, you know, thanks very much. I'll come with you because I had no clue about the place. So wonderful people. We again had a lot of fun talking to them. Very supportive, Vivek. Very supportive of young faculty who were struggling to stand on their feet soon after a PhD. So I was in Syracuse just for 1 year. That particular year happened to be very difficult on the hiring front. So that was the most that I could manage. And I had to apply again, you know. So
it is amazing to hear that, you know, this professor was so helpful.
And, yes.
He went out of the way to help you settle down at Syracuse.
Yes, yes, yes.
So could you please share your experiences at the University of Michigan, Ann Arbor? And here again, you know, there is this incident that all your friends know about of driving your new car to the library and forgetting about it and coming back to your apartment by bus.
Yes, yes. So Vivek, in those days, you know, the you know, the top-notch places, very active places to study complex analysis was the University of Michigan, Ann Arbor, simply because they had a very large group, you know, unlike Bloomington and Syracuse, where there were few people, but very active. Michigan had a very large number of people. So there was John Eric Furness, Berit Stensonis, Al Taylor, Dan Burns, a whole bunch of people, you know, Matthias Johnson and so on. So this was a very big group. And being a large department, every year they would hire about 12 to 14 postdocs. So they had a very vibrant postdoc culture also. And so being in Ann Arbor and doing several complex variables was a very interesting period for me because I got this chance to talk to some of the leading experts, you know, in this area. Again, I must mention Dave Barrett. Dave Barrett was the other name I was forgetting. So Furness, Berit Stensonis, Dave Barrett, Al Taylor, Dan Burns. Yeah, five people, yeah. Again, very, very supportive, Vivek, very supportive, very friendly people. And you actually got to see how the subject was developing, you know, at first hand. So I was in Ann Arbor for 4 years. I had a lot of fun talking to these people, learning from them. And in Ann Arbor, you know, the second of my absent-minded episodes actually happened. This was, I think, in my third year, I think, in Ann Arbor. So, you know, I was staying away from the university, and, you know, I had a bus pass, you know, so which I would use to go to office every day. So it so happened that I realized that, oh, look, you know, tomorrow is the last day of the bus pass, and I better extend it. So I told Renuka that I'm going to go to downtown and get this renewed. So I drive to this place in downtown. I stand in the line, and I get a brand new bus pass, you know. And the nice thing was that the card was, it had a new design, you know. So there was a new branding that was done, and it had a very nice shiny look and feel. And I was lost in this, and I said, oh, look, what a nice little card. And when I look up, I find a bus that's about to leave the station. I said, oh, look, that's my bus, you know. So without thinking, I get into the bus, and 10 minutes later, I am at home. And when I ring the doorbell, you know, here is Renuka asking me, oh, you are back. And I said, yes, I'm back. I took the bus. And then she's totally shocked. He said, but where's the car? You know, and this is when it struck me that, oh, I had actually, you know, taken the car to downtown, and I had forgotten it there completely, you know. So I had to take the bus back again, and then this time make sure I get the car back. Yeah, so again, you know, fun little thing that I enjoy sharing with everyone. Yeah.
Moving to the Indian Institute of Science, I think you moved back to IISc in 2004. So yes. Could you please describe your experiences of teaching and research at IISc?
Yes. So I joined IISc in July of 2004. It was a small department then. I think about there were 12 or 13 people. The department was structured along the lines of what I had seen in Bloomington and Syracuse and Ann Arbor, you know, Vivek. So there were these graduate level courses. So you take on students for a PhD. There were seminars that were running and so on. So there wasn't any fundamental difference, you know. So I settled down very quickly. I was actually quite excited to be back in India after a long stay in the US. And even though I had been in Bangalore only once before as a tourist, you know, I found myself very comfortable, even though I had no knowledge of Canada, you know. So everything was so beautiful, you know. I was really enjoying myself. Great campus, wonderful colleagues. It was a lot of fun. So what I found really nice was there were three other people who had joined at roughly the same time. One was Narayanan, then Harish, and Srikant. So all of us joined at roughly the same time, Vivek. So the bonding was of a special kind, you know. So Harish and I shared an office, and we immediately started talking some mathematics. And I said, look, you know, let's do something together. And that's how, you know, we ended up writing a bunch of, you know, interesting articles, you know. And Naru is, of course, such a lot of fun, you know. And Srikant and his family, you know, we've been sort of very, very close. Our kids have grown up together. And it's just been a wonderful opportunity to be here. And then, you know, all this was happening when we had very proactive chairpersons. Rangarajan, for example, was the head of the department when I joined. He was followed by Mrinal, and then followed by Ganadhar Mishra, and now Thangavelu. So I think the department has grown considerably. I would like to say that, you know, it's a very, very friendly place, a very vibrant place, and, you know, such a transparent sort of bunch of, you know, people there and colleagues. It's been fun, Vivek. It's the whole thing has been very, very rewarding in some sense.
That is great to hear about the early history of your stay at IISc. So, says it's good to know that things have changed enormously from 2004 to 2021 in terms of growth of the department.
Growth of the department. Yes, Vivek. Yes.
Kaushal, as a person who primarily likes mathematics, how have you dealt with the administrative responsibilities that both at the Indian Institute of Science and also at the building where you're currently staying?
Yes. I'll share a personal philosophy with you, Vivek, here. You know, I think that, you know, we as individuals define the systems that we are part of. Yeah. So I'm a faculty member in a certain institution. I'm a resident of a certain, you know, society here. I'm part of this, I'm part of that, and so on. And I think it is very important for, and I think it's important for me to be able to contribute to these organizations at every level, you know. Doing my mathematics is one thing. It's very easy for me to lock myself up in a room and forget about everything else. But, you know, when I see the... When I think about it, Vivek, you know, I realize that there is much more to an organization than just being, than just doing your own work, you know. So I have a personal philosophy that I would like to contribute to my workplace, to the society where I stay. And I think it's it sort of comes naturally to me, Vivek. You know, I find it very difficult to shut myself up and ignore everything else in some sense. So it so happens that if there is something to be done, I don't mind volunteering for it. I said, look, I'll do it, but as long as I get some help and so on, let's do it together. So that's been my philosophy, actually. Yeah. So it's been all right. It's every administrative position does bring with it responsibilities and so on, but I think it's an interesting exposure. I think it's a learning experience for me, and it's a chance to contribute to the overall growth and development of the place. That's about it. Yeah.
Kaushal, given your numerous awards and honors, which of them gave you the most amount of satisfaction?
Okay. I'll tell you a story, Vivek. I'll tell you a story. So I, for a long time, I have sort of, you know, gone to various instructional workshops and schools across the country. These are, month-long, not month-long, I would say maybe 2 or 3 week duration workshops, in which various people come for short durations. You teach a very diverse audience of students and you go back, you know. So these are actually being run by IIT Bombay. They have a center called the National Center for Mathematics. And these are what are called the Advanced Training in Mathematics, ATM schools. So they started in 2006, and I made it a point to participate in as many as I could for several years. Simply because, you know, again, I thought, Vivek, you know, we have to teach well, otherwise, how are you going to inspire the next generation of students, you know? So that was my philosophy. Some years ago, I happened to go to one such school, and there was a student who walked up to me at the end of day one. And he said, sir, you may not recognize me, but I have met you before. And I want to really thank you for everything that you have done for me. And I said, well, that's very nice, but, you know, I don't really recognize you. So can you please, remind me of where we first met? So he said, yeah, sure. You know, it was such and such place, and you were giving this series of lectures, and I was in the audience. I said, okay, wonderful. So what are you doing now? And how did I help you? So he said, no, you know, I asked you several questions about what to do in my life. How should I study? Which exams should I clear? And which PhD program can I possibly join? And he said, you know, whatever you told me, I sort of followed right to the dot. And here I am. I'm in a PhD program, and I'm very happy, Vivek. And Vivek, I had no memory of this meeting. Absolutely no memory. I did not recognize the student. But whatever I might have told him actually struck a chord in this person, and it helped him, in moving ahead. This has happened not once, Vivek. It has happened several times. And this has been my best reward so far. I think this is absolutely priceless. Coming to official recognitions like some fellowships or awards and so on, Vivek, I think an award is actually a recognition of the completion of a certain work, perhaps, or maybe the introduction of a new idea or a new way of thinking in a certain larger project. Okay, so it's an official recognition by a certain group of people. To me, that's pretty much it. Getting an award or a fellowship is neither necessary or sufficient to certify anybody as a good researcher or an impactful teacher, or more importantly, as a good human being. If it comes, you accept it with grace, say thank you and move on. If it does not, there are many, many other very interesting things to do in life. So I have been sort of fortunate to get some of these recognitions. They have, of course, as I said, in my mind, yes, a certain amount of work was done, so it's an official recognition for that. But they have in no way actually increased my happiness quotient in any way, they are there, I'm happy. There's much more to life than all of that.
Kaushal, those stories were very inspiring about those students, whose life were changed by attending your lecture and being guided by you. That's very nice to hear. Could you please talk about the mathematicians who have influenced you a lot? You've already mentioned, several mathematicians who influenced you, but could you paint a much broader canvas of mathematicians, who have influenced you during the course of your professional career?
Okay. So Vivek, I will, not stick to people, legendary people like all of us know about, like Riemann and Gauss and Ramanujan, These are so removed from our times that I don't really want to talk about them. We've all read about them. They've all done fantastic work. But, I cannot touch them because they belong to a different era. So I'm going to focus on people that I came in contact with and I have directly benefited from. So I would like to start with Khanapure in class 11 and 12, Vivek, simply because of the first impression that he put upon me. Such a wonderful person, very friendly, he knew the subject, and he had a very distinctive style of his own. In IIT Bombay, I would like to mention B.V. Limai and Akhil Ranjan. B.V. Limai, because, he very generously agreed to be my seminar guide, and he gave me, he listened to all my incredibly stupid questions and made sure that I was able to learn something during the course of that semester, so that was Limai. Akhil Ranjan, simply because, he was such a kind man, very, very friendly and very giving, very generous. He put up with me for an entire year, and he even wrote letters, so did Limai, in support of my application. Moving on, I must also mention Vinay Devdhar at Bloomington. Devdhar was the chairperson when I landed up there, and he evidently saw something in my application which made him send me an offer of admission. You know, he was probably familiar with my letter writers. He probably was familiar with the background that I was coming from. And here was a person who was actually able to say, no, look, let's give him a chance. And Devdar was somebody who taught me lots and lots of courses in algebra. So whatever little algebra I know today is because of him. Yeah. Then the four people that I mentioned, Sergey Pinchuk, Eric Bedford, Tom Bagby, and Norm Levenberg, for actually teaching me the subject, Vivek, you know, and driving home the finer nuances of various things. Then I would like to mention Poletsky again, you know, again, a very generous person, but very distinctive style in mathematics. Very, very clear-cut ideas about how the subject should be done. And if I may use the word, totally bindas, you know, of all these people, Poletsky was, you know, right there, like a hero in some sense, you know, very dashing person. Then, of course, John Eric Fornes, very influential complex analyst, very shy, you know, socially very, very shy, I would say, not prone to giving lectures and so on, but much more comfortable chatting with students, inspiring them and, you know, proving theorems with them and so on. Bennett Stensonis, his wife, Dave Barrett, Dan Burns, Al Taylor. Yeah, it was just amazing, Vivek, you know, just listening to these people and learning from them, Vivek. Yeah. So these are some people that I have learned from. And back here now, you know, I have been sort of reading through some of the older papers of M.S. Narasimhan, a very famous Indian mathematician. And he's a person who comes across as somebody with impeccable taste, you know, very deeply knowledgeable about various aspects of mathematics, both in analysis as well as the geometric parts. And it's just been so rewarding, you know, trying to read some of his older papers and so on. Yeah. So yeah, Vivek, you know, I've been sort of influenced by so many of these people here. Whatever I've been able to learn is entirely due to them.
That's really great to hear, Kaushal. For the benefit of our audience, could you please provide a broad overview of the various branches of mathematics and their interconnections?
Okay. So roughly speaking, Vivek, you know, people talk about analysis, there is algebra and topology / geometry. So these are three broad disciplines, subdivisions, basically. Analysis, of course, encompasses things like harmonic analysis, complex analysis, operator theory, and a big chunk of ideas there. One of the characterizing features of analysis is that, you know, you have to really get your hands dirty in understanding the functions that you're dealing with or certain properties thereof and so on. Yeah. Algebra, on the other hand, again, is a very diverse thing. You know, you have number theory, representation theory, commutative algebra, algebraic number theory. So again, it's a very, very broad area. But the flavor is different, with it. Flavor, you know, on the outside. So it's very different. topology, on the other hand, at first sight may appear to be a very coarse study of spaces. You know, you really don't sort of get your hands that dirty and so on. But, you know, after spending so many years in this business, one realizes that even though the superficial appearances may be vastly different, at the end of it all, you know, Vivek, it's a bunch of ideas and there is a central unity to everything, basically, you know. So beyond a point, algebra, analysis, geometry, topology, it's all the boundaries disappear in some sense. Yeah. So it's like, you know, you know, different kinds of cuisine that we have in the country, you know. So we have a Gujarati thali versus a South Indian thali versus a North Indian thali or whatever it is. Ultimately, it's food. It's interesting food. And you just take your pick, you know, depending on the mood of the day, you know, that kind of thing. So
yeah. That's an interesting analogy, Kaushik. So could you please speak about your area of research in mathematics to a general audience?
Sure, Vivek. So let me start with what students learn in class 11. You know, this is the time when the students learn about complex numbers. Yeah, so they are taught that a complex number is something that has a real part and an imaginary part. So you write it in the form of x plus iy. And then the syllabus will tell you things like, you know, the polar representation. So you have r e to the I theta. Then you have, you know, this this fabulous formula which says e to the I theta is cosine theta plus I sine theta and so on. So so that's the beginning of the introduction of complex variables to a student these days, right? So what they learn in school is basically the algebra of complex numbers. Algebra of how do you manipulate them and work with them, basically, right? But the real game actually starts when you move beyond this thing. So you are no longer interested in just generic properties of complex numbers, but you start thinking about complex valued functions. So you think of functions not on the real line now, yeah, which we are all accustomed to, but you think of f as a function of the complex variable z, right? So f can be thought of as a function from the complex plane c to the complex plane c. So the input is a pair x comma y, and the output is again a pair, say u comma v. So u is the real part of f and v is the imaginary part of f. Yeah. And what makes complex analysis very fascinating is because you know, you take the notion of derivatives, you know, which we all learn in class 11. So you talk about differentiable functions and their properties like Rolle's theorem, Taylor's theorem, and so on and so forth. So there's an entire calculus which is built for the category of complex functions. So you talk about complex differentiability, and it turns out that the moment you are complex differentiable, Vivek, simply because you are in the complex world, a number of remarkable miracles start happening just because you happen to be complex differentiable. Yeah, it's unbelievable, but this is it. Complex analysis is the study of all these miracles. And each miracle tells you how special these functions are. And so one ends up thinking that if you have very special functions, they ought to have very rigid properties, simply because special means you are not, you know, like a generic object, you know. So you better have certain characterizing features, and that's the whole beauty, Vivek. So the study is the study of the subject is the study of all these rigid properties. so there's an entire calculus that is built. You study this very beautiful calculus. That's the one variable story. So you have a function that's defined on the complex plane. Now, moving on to several complex variables. So you have this word several, which is coming before complex variables, right? So several complex variables means your domain is no longer just a copy of the complex plane. You take the Cartesian product of the complex plane with itself n number of times. So you get Cn. So that's you know, a linear space, and every element in it is actually an n tuple of complex numbers. So you look at functions that depend on these n complex parameters, right? The incredible thing is these functions in higher variables, Vivek, they possess a number of very remarkable properties, properties which make no sense in the complex plane. So they are invisible. They make their presence felt only when you go to two or more complex dimensions. And this is the subject of complex dimension, complex analysis at higher dimensions. Yeah. So the study of these remarkable properties. So that's what I do, roughly speaking. And it has a number of applications, you know, just because of the way of thinking and so on. So there are applications in theoretical physics and things of that sort.
Very fascinating to hear, Kaushal. Going back to the point that you made, you know, where you actually interacted with people whom you had influenced at an early stage of life in with inputs on how to pursue mathematics and so on. So for the benefit of our audience, could you actually give some advice to a young person who could be interested in pursuing mathematics as a career?
Sure, Vivek. To such a person, I would say, Vivek, you know, it's very important to learn a little bit of history, to learn a little bit of poetry, to get some understanding of the sciences. If you learn all these things, Vivek, I think you'll be a better mathematician. On the other hand, if you learn a little bit of mathematics, you will be a much better historian, a much better biologist, a much better physicist, a much better chemist. So to a young person who's thinking about studying mathematics, my advice would be try and learn as many things as possible now. Yeah, there will be a time when you will be forced to specialize. But don't bring that time now. You know, there is a tendency in the younger generation to specialize at a very, very early age. I think that is not quite healthy all the time. I would say just have a lot of fun, learn many things, and do whatever it takes to, you know, go to the next step in your career. Yeah, everything will be fine, in my opinion. Yeah, don't specialize too early. Yeah,
that's really nice to hear, Kaushal. And your friends from IIT remember you as someone who was extremely helpful to everyone. This is the, you know, the inputs that I have received from many of your friends from Hostel 3 at IIT and many of your classmates of you know, engineering physics. And one thing I would like to share with our viewers is that during my final year at IIT Bombay, Kaushal actually helped me with my BTech project. on a mathematical topic, you know, so there was a part of the, you know, there was part of some theorem which required some contour integration. So actually, Kaushal and incidentally, that was on the complex plane. So actually, you helped me solve that part of the puzzle, as it were. So, so you've been extremely helpful to, you know, your friends and a lot of people, not only in IIT but, you know, I'll say throughout your you know, life. That is also true of your students and so on. You know, that has been you know, really amazing. So one question I would like to ask is that it's more a you know, more a personality related question. That given your natural introvertedness, how do you manage to be successful in being so helpful?
I don't know, Vivek. You know, for a very long time now, I seem to have this intuitive feeling about what the other person is going through without, you know, having too many discussions with them. I sort of have this instinctive feeling, you know, with many, many people, even with our grocery person, you know, next to, I sort of have this intuitive understanding, Vivek, you know. I think this sort of goes back to the way I was raised in some sense, you know, our family and so on. And, you know, whenever I get this sense, I know that, yes, you know, there is the other person has a certain need, you know, which needs to be fulfilled in some sense. So earlier on, I would sort of make attempts to actually actively engage with the person on a one-on-one basis, you know, without the other person realizing that I'm trying to do this. I wanted to help. I wanted to ease the discomfort which I was sensing in the other person. But then, you know, as you grow up and you see your share of the world, you sort of realize that very often all that the other person is wanting is somebody to listen to, somebody to, you know, somebody who understands their view. And this sort of seems to come very naturally to me, Vivek. You know, I seem to orient myself very easily to understand what the other person is saying. You know, I think this is what enables me to get this intuitive feeling. And even while and having said this, I must also say that you know, it's not as if I sort of, you know, get turned around completely. Because to help, you know, I have to be on a stronger footing. You know, I cannot sort of afford to see the other person drown and then drown myself in the whole process. So there has to be a certain internal resisting force which sort of brings me back, you know, in some sense. So all along, it's been this sort of simple harmonic motion. You know, you sort of bend a little bit and then bring it back, bring myself back, and then bend a little bit, and then, you know, that kind of thing. And this happens very naturally. I don't have to do anything, Vivek. You know, it's not as if I mean, it's very nice that people sort of remember me in a certain way. It's sort of very gratifying. I'm very thankful to all of them. But all I can say is, you know, I did not do anything special. It just happened so naturally. I'm very thankful for the opportunity, actually, you know.
That is very nice to hear, Kaushal. You know, it's about the way in which you're able to intuitively sense how the other person is feeling, and based on that, you know, kind of reach out.
Right.
So that is so that's completely amazing. So I think that property, you know, is a very special one. That's a very special you know, quality to have. You know, a lot more of that is needed in this world which we live in. So thank you very much, Kaushal, for participating in this timeless interview. It was really a great pleasure to chat with you on a variety of topics. And I learned a lot about you during this discussion. Even though I have been in close contact with you over the years. So it is amazing that how an interview such as this brings out new information that somebody who has known you very well for so many years was completely unaware of. For example, you know, your chemistry lab experiments as a, you know, school kid, the stories that you shared of Indiana Bloomington.
Yes.
And about the professor at Syracuse going out of his way to make you settle down, about the environment in Michigan, such a strong group there. So there are many different aspects of this interview which was completely new to me. So thanks a lot, Kaushal.
Yeah,
it's absolutely great to talk to you.
Yeah, thank you very much, Vivek. You know, as I have told you on past occasions also, I think you're doing a terrific job with this series of interviews. I think it's a wonderful idea that you have you know, taken to a wonderful level, and thank you very much. It's been an honor to be a participant here. Thank you.
So thanks a lot, Kaushal.
Thank you.